Today I'm talking about my top 5 recommendations for the best photography cameras under $1,000. Let's get into it. What up, friends? Welcome back to the channel. I appreciate you being here. And buying a new camera, upgrading your gear, or just getting started in the photography game can be stressful and a little bit overwhelming when you start looking at the options. And today my goal is to alleviate some of that stress, give you some really quality high-end recommendations, and the best value you can get for under $1,000. I chose that price point because I felt like some of the very cheap, low-end cameras, you're just gonna outgrow those pretty quickly. So I like this $1,000 intermediate level price point. And I think the market is saturated right now with some really good options. As a professional photographer, I also know some of the things that you may not need and some of the gimmicky type features that kind of just are more marketing ploys. So I try to look past those and give you options that are just the best value and things you won't outgrow so quickly. So without further ado, let's get in my list. First, my list is the Sony A6100. That camera comes in at $749 currently for body only. I owned this camera for a long time and I really do love this camera. I ended up selling it because some of the video options were just kind of bugging me. But today we're talking about photography only. So for that, I actually really like this camera. It's a really good option. It's got one of the class leading autofocus systems and it has real time eye tracking autofocus, meaning that you will really never miss your focus subject and it'll be locked onto your eye, whether it's a human or a pet. And I just really like that system overall. It's kind of just a weight lifted off your shoulders knowing that you're not gonna miss your shot. It also has 11 frames per second, so the burst modes are pretty good. You could shoot some decent action and some moving subjects with that and not have to worry about missing your subject. I also love that it has USB charging. That's a big plus for me. Flip up tilting screen. It's kind of a pro and a con. At least you have some type of selfie screen, but if you're gonna be throwing any kind of microphone or external hot shoe accessory that you want on there, it's gonna block the screen, so it's kind of annoying. It does have Wi-Fi, NFC, Bluetooth, and a decent Sony app to transfer those photos quickly over to your smartphone. So if you're shooting in JPEG, that is a nice little option to have. I do like the punchy photos that are coming out of this, and the raw photos are actually quite nice. They're nice files to work with. However, it's a little bit of an older sensor, so that is a con I have with this unit. The sensor is the same sensor found in the old 6300, 6500 series cameras, and those are about 5 years old now, so Sony hasn't done much to update this sensor. It is a good sensor for photography and it does put out good images still, but I would like to see the sensor updated somewhat soon. Some other cons I have with this unit are no in-body image stabilization, so your low light performance is gonna suffer a little bit there. It also doesn't have a very good menu system. Sony is kind of known for that until recently when they updated that. The battery life is subpar, and I also feel like the lack of a front dial for the manual controls is something that hindered my photography when I was using this camera. Overall ergonomics and feel of the body were quite nice. It felt quality, not cheap at all. I just found it enjoyable to use for photography. So that is the Sony A6100. I would recommend it, but I would also look at some others on the list. Up next on my list is the Canon M50 Mark II. Now that is a newer rendition of the very popular Canon M50 Mark I. This one comes in at $699 currently for the body only. I really like this camera, and one thing that I love personally is having a smaller lightweight camera for an everyday carry or travel type unit for photography. And the M50 really checks those boxes there. It's a small, lightweight, compact camera that just feels good in your hand. Now that being said, that lightweight is attributed to a plastic, cheapy type feel design. So that's something quality purposes I could give a thumbs down. However, the dual pixel autofocus is top notch and just competes right up there with the Sony system. You won't miss, it's really, really good, especially for photography and in video as well. At 7.4 frames per second, this unit is moderately speed for burst, and so I wouldn't take this if you're going to be shooting a lot of fast action. But I will say that Canon color science trickles down onto this unit from some of their higher end models, and it's an absolutely fantastic color science. The colors that Canon produces have always been beautiful to my eye. That is subjective for some, but I just really love it. Also has Wi-Fi, NFC, Bluetooth, and an excellent app for transferring photos over, so that is a plus for Canon. It also has a very good electronic viewfinder. High resolution, bright, beautiful, so it is nice to shoot in sunlight. Fully articulating touchscreen is also very nice to have. I really enjoy that, especially if you're gonna be shooting self-shot photography in any way, shape, or form. Really just a nice unit and much, much better than the tilting screens on some of the other options. So my cons for this unit are no USB charging, no in-body image stabilization, so the low light performance is gonna suffer a little bit there. Bad battery life, cheap body feel. It's kind of a plasticky type feeling, like I said. And also the kit lens is very subpar. I wouldn't recommend this kit lens at all. The lens selection for these units are somewhat new, but they are putting a good effort into building the lens selection out, as well as some third party have just recently picked up on it. So Sigma, Tamron's gonna start producing some lenses for that. So I really like that the lens selection is growing here. Overall, I really like the M50 Mark II and the Mark I, especially if you're gonna be doing some YouTube and video type work as well. It's a really great unit for that. 4K video is not usable still. That being said, I would say for the price point, this is an excellent place to look. At $699, it's the cheapest on my list, but let's take a look at some others. Up next is something I rarely recommend lately, and that is a Nikon Z50. This unit comes in at $856 currently for body only, and I actually really like this camera. I recently had the pleasure of shooting this thing, and I really was pleasantly surprised. It feels really good in the hand, and the thing that stood out the most to me is that it feels like a much higher end model than it really is. I attribute that to the magnesium alloy body that Nikon built this thing from, and it comes down from some of their higher end bodies. It's still small, compact, but it just feels sturdy. It's not the lightest weight camera, especially for this list, but it feels really good in the hand. It feels like it's gonna last you a really long time. Some other things that I liked that stood out to me are good ergonomics, front and rear dials for the manual controls. It just felt like a professional unit, and I like that at this price point. It does have a good sensor. Some beautiful images are coming out of this camera, and I think you won't be disappointed there. The colors for Nikon, I wouldn't say are comparable to Canon, or maybe even to Sony right now, but it's still really beautiful, crisp images that I enjoyed. I really like them. Another big plus for this unit is there's no 4K crop in video, but we're not gonna talk about video features too much. All right, let's get into the cons for this camera. So first off, the tilting screen is just a little bit subpar. I wish it was a fully articulating screen. The lack of in-body image stabilization was a bit disappointing. The lens lineup for this thing is still pretty minimal. The other things I noticed that are the 5 frames per second that it's rated is just very slow. That's like 7 year body technology that we should have seen a long time ago. We should see more than that now. And if you're shooting any type of fast action, that's gonna be problematic for you here. The other thing I did notice is it's a little bit sluggish, I would call it, for the autofocus. I found it to be a bit slow for my liking, and I was hoping to be snappier, but again, I'm comparing it to Sony's top of the line autofocus system as well as Canon, so it's a little bit biased there. If you're a newer shooter or if you're not coming off of Sony or Canon, you're probably not going to know it to be annoying, but to me it was an annoyance. I did like that the battery life was better than some of the other units, and again, it just felt sturdy to me of a unit overall, so I felt like it was very well built. At the $856 price point, I would be willing to get this camera if you're willing to jump into the Nikon ecosystem. If you're willing to invest in good Nikon Z glass and build and grow as you go up in the bodies, then that's okay. And I think this is a very good camera, and I think it puts out beautiful images. If I'm bringing you some value, hit me with a thumbs up and subscribe. Let's talk about the next camera. Up next on my list is a newer camera, and that is the Fuji XS10. This camera comes in at $999 body only, so it's the top of my price point. But I absolutely am blown away by the specs on this thing. This camera is very impressive. If you know the Fuji lineup, you know the X-T4 and how it's hailed and just has very good reviews. Well, this XS10 is basically an X-T4, the exact same guts of that camera, shrunken down into a smaller body with a little bit less of the high-end features. That to me is just very, very promising because those internals have already been proven in the X-T4 and people love them. The images that camera put out are just absolutely stunning and top notch. So for $1,000, I would say the value right off the bat is very there for the XS10. All right, let's get into the pros for this camera. First off, fully articulating touchscreen, in-body image stabilization, so low light performance is better. 20 frames per second continuous burst. So this is a very fast camera. If you're shooting any type of action or fast moving subjects, you could start with this camera on my list. This blows away some of their competition, especially that Nikon. Some other things I really like are the 2.36 million dot electronic viewfinder. I find that to be sharp, beautiful, very, very high end, and it just really feels good on a camera at this price point. Pair that with the articulating screen, and that's just something you don't really see paired up together for $1,000. Love the ergonomics on this thing. It has a joystick on the back as well as dual manual control dials. Felt really nice. That joystick was really nice for moving around my focus point quickly and accurately. Really love that. Fantastic sensor, as I talked about. It's already a proven sensor in the X-T4, so can't complain there. Does have USB charging. Just overall, I can't complain much about this camera. I can nitpick a little bit. Let's get into some of the cons. Film simulations, like in the Nikon, are very gimmicky. I don't like them at all and wouldn't recommend them. I think it's a marketing ploy. I also would say that the ergonomics aren't traditional, so I would hold this camera and see if you like it. The grip is a little bit funky. It kind of felt, I don't know, it felt weird to me. It didn't feel natural when I picked this camera up. So that's something you need to think about. And I also would think about, you know, jumping into the Fuji lineup. Fuji does not have a full frame camera currently. So if you're going to invest in this camera, you have to be willing to take on that crop sensor body lineup and be able to move up in that lineup. Now, that being said, some of their high end bodies that they do offer are very, very good, professional worthy. I would be willing to shoot weddings on them currently. So it's something I wouldn't hesitate to jump into Fuji, but something that you should be aware of. At $999, the XS10 is just a superb value. I would definitely recommend this camera. Some of the early testers have complained about the autofocus missing some of the eye autofocus or false reads, but I'd probably say that's gonna be updated in further firmware updates, and Fuji's been known to correct issues like that. So I would say the camera is a high recommend. It is new on the market, so if you're hesitant about buying new models, you should think about that, but I recommend this one. Let's take a look at the next one. All right, I'm down to my last two cameras, and these are both very quality cameras that I absolutely love. Another Fuji comes on the list next, at the Fuji X-T30. This one's currently $899, body only, and this camera is just very popular, very good reviews, already proven a reliable quality unit for photography. Again, this camera has a fantastic sensor, already proven, comes down for some of their higher end bodies as well. Also comes in at 20 frames per second continuous burst, so just very fast, good for speed and fast action. 2.36 million dot viewfinder is also excellent. I really like that. As well as the ergonomics and front rear dials, as well as a joystick. Just really thought of all the things that you would need. Like similar to the XS10, I just love all these features. It just feels very high end. The thing I love most about this camera, and it's kind of stupid, but aesthetically this camera is beautiful. It's got that retro rangefinder type feel. It even has a two-tone model that I just think looks really good. It's one of those cameras that when I had it for a while, I found myself picking it up quite often and using it more just because it was a cool camera. It felt nice, it looked good. Pair it with a leather strap, and it's just a cool looking camera. I really like it. Now, some cons for this camera, some of them are video features. It has a 4K 10 minute max. So one thing that was a deal breaker for me was you can't shoot more than 10 minutes for 4K. Don't like that. There's no grip on this thing. Again, it's kind of like a rangefinder type feel, so it's a little bit slippery. No in-body image stabilization. And the tilt screen, it's just something I don't like. I would like a fully articulating. So if I'm comparing the two Fuji models that are on my list, the XS10 versus the X-T30, I'd probably lean to the XS10. It is a little bit more expensive, about $100 more expensive. Both put out very nice photos that I really love. So they're both excellent quality units that I'd recommend. But if I were comparing the two, I'd probably go XS10. Up last on my list, and the clear-cut winner for me, is the EOS RP by Canon. This camera comes in at $999 for body only, and it's a clear-cut winner. This thing is still very impressive and underrated, in my opinion, ever since it came out. Now, I think many people look past this camera because its big brother siblings are so dominant in the field and feature-packed, but this camera at $1,000 is just such a great value. I would dream about jumping into full frame, which this camera is the only full frame camera on my list. I would dream about jumping into full frame as a beginner or intermediate, because then you don't have to waste your money buying glass on a crop sensor body and then having to get rid of all that doesn't work when you move up to full frame. Skip that step, save your money, invest in this camera, start investing in full frame glass and be able to move up and use this camera as a fantastic B camera should the time come when you wanna move up the line in the Canon lineup. This camera's feature packed, it still does very well. I would not hesitate to shoot this camera right now to shoot a wedding. Excellent low light performance, excellent depth of field control with the full frame. Color science is still top notch coming out of Canon. Still has dual pixel autofocus, so the autofocus system is very strong. Ergonomics are good. It's quality built. I think it'll last you a really long time. The adapter that Canon offers to allow you native Legacy EF glass just opens the door to so many lens options. As well as Canon building up this mirrorless lens lineup, you just have a lot of good lens selection and you can start investing in that full frame lens lineup. And I just really think that's a good investment. Fully articulating screen, good ergonomics, dual manual control dials. I mean, this camera just does a lot of things well and there's not a lot for me to complain about. One of the things I love the most is the silent shutter feature. That's just a high-end feature. If you're shooting in a church or you're shooting a baptism or baby photography or animal photography and you want it silent, well, this camera can do that, and that's one of the only cameras on this list that can do that. Just a great feature to have. So it's definitely not a perfect camera. There are some cons. Let's get into those. First off, no image stabilization built in, so no IBIS. Low light performance is going to suffer a little bit there. Also, it's a very slow camera. It only shoots 4 frames per second. So if you're shooting any type of action, this is not the camera for you. Also has 4K crop issues, so the 4K is basically unusable in my opinion. Now, we're not talking about video here, but it's something I should mention, as well as the Canon glass, the native mirrorless glass that they are starting to build for this unit is very expensive. So although you're paying $999 for the body, you are gonna spend more money on full frame glass as compared to some of the other units on my list. So that is something to think about if you have a limited budget or you're not thinking about upgrading in the future and you don't care about a crop sensor. Those crop sensor lenses are gonna be significantly cheaper, if not moderately cheaper, than the full frame options on this camera. However, if you can afford this camera, I would say go for it. The images that come out of this thing are absolutely stunning. They are beautiful in every sense of the word. I'm not being dramatic either. I just really like them. I really like the lens lineup. I really like the Canon color science. I really like just the quality that Canon gives you here for $1,000. It's an absolute recommend from me. To close this video off, I'd like to say it's always more important to invest in good quality glass. All of these cameras are excellent cameras, but if you shoot them with kit lenses or slower, cheaper lenses, you're still not gonna get very good images. So as you grow in photography, be willing to invest in quality lenses and you're gonna see your photos just increase. Increase in quality tenfold. It's going to be an exponential growth, much more than just upgrading your body. So I always like to preach, it's all about the glass. So with that, that's all I got for this list. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, subscribe and stick with me for more videos just like this. Get out there, get your camera, and get to shooting. I appreciate you guys. Talk to you in the next one. Clear out the room, I'm coming through. They want to see what I'm about. Yeah, I got skills, do it for the thrill. I'm on a paper route. Extra, read about it. I'm today's trying to tell.